Symptoms arrived on March 17th, and this was after having spent 10 days in London, and we were fairly confident that we contracted this thing while we were in London. There were many events that we attended that had a couple hundred people. They were in fairly close proximity to each other, whether it was a cocktail party or an official dinner or something like that, or even just a lecture. So I showed symptoms on the 17th. My wife never actually showed symptoms, but then about a week later, after a great deal of effort, we were able to get tested. That is a story all by itself. We both tested positive, and so for the weeks after until now, we stayed in isolation. By good fortune, our younger son flew in from Los Angeles for nearly 3 weeks. He's just flying back today to take care of shopping and cooking. So we had more than many other people have in the way of help and assistance to get through the recovery process.
But wasn't he concerned about contracting it as well?
Absolutely. And so he exercised enormous care. He was up in the upstairs bedrooms and we never went up there. He disinfected himself and his hands and the kitchen counter and all the other stuff on it repeatedly. He would wash off anything that came in from the store. We designated certain areas as germ-free areas. And so we're careful not to put anything on there that hadn't already been essentially cleaned. So so he was very, very, conscientious about exercising all of the normal precautions that it is recommended in order to stay isolated. And so far as we can tell, over that three-week period, he did not show any signs of any symptoms, anyway, of this disease. And when he gets back to Los Angeles today, he said that he will self-isolate for another 14 days.
So was he able to get tested before he left?
No, we were not able to get tests for him. But frankly, given the gestation period, we are pretty confident that if he was going to show any symptoms at all, they would have appeared during the period that he was here. Many, many people were kind enough to send notes. I had not intended to say anything, and I was encouraged to be public about this for a couple of reasons. And one of them was that that maybe people would listen, just given my modest notoriety. So I tried to use social media very sparingly to reinforce the good practices with regard to social isolation, which, by the way, I think is a peculiar term. Physical isolation is what we're after, not social isolation.
All of what is happening in the world is becoming more and more interconnected, just as we're doing right now, because of the internet.
Well, it's a very interesting question. You know, how would we communicate? Well, we had other mass media available. I mean, we have television, we have cable TV, we have the telephone, we have radio. People probably would be, by the way, there's a lot of telephone usage right now. Even it's gone up even faster than some of the social media and things like these calls. So that's important to know. Of course, having mobiles readily available has assisted in the use of the telephone system. So there would have been other ways to keep people informed. What would not have worked, however, is the ability to work from home for at least a significant fraction of the workforce. And internet has certainly enabled that. And to say nothing of schools going online, as imperfect as that might be. So I agree with you that some of our response to the COVID-19 virus pandemic has been enabled by internet, and if we had not had this capability, I think we would have been less able to respond to the situation, admitting that many of the internet-based responses are still not adequate, but they are surely a step in the right direction. which leads many of us to speculate that post-COVID-19, that our normal lives will have shifted in some way. For example, companies may be more willing to allow people to work from home when that's convenient. And that might actually be a very beneficial thing for at least some portion of the workforce, giving them flexibility that they might not otherwise have. And it might also induce ways of using online capability for education that would, I would say, enhance or expand the business models of schools and universities. So I think the post-pandemic period will be interesting and absolutely worthy of our scrutiny. But that gets to one other thing, which is most relevant to why you and I are talking, and that is to be more conscious of the importance of accessibility in all dimensions for these online systems. We have still not done well in achieving what I consider to be a very important objective, which is making online capacity usable for everyone, including those who have to overcome various and sundry kinds of disabilities. And so that challenge lies before us and is just as much a challenge now as it has been in the past.
I know you're working with Google. You're working at Google, I guess I should say.
I had gone from the research department for some 12 years or so, then to policy, and now most recently I'm part of the cloud team. In all cases, however, I've had a finger in the policy space, specifically policy related to internet, how it's used, how it's abused, what to do about that. So that's one part. I am a sponsor of our accessibility efforts at Google and also a sponsor of some of the internal employee groups, interest groups, for example, the Disabilities Alliance, which is a group of employees who either are disabled or have children who are disabled or parents who are disabled or who have disabling conditions. And part of the purpose behind that activity is to draw attention to the accommodations that are needed, whether that has to do with accessibility of online systems or you know, making sure that for the blind employees that there are paths that are clear and that we don't leave things around for people to trip on. There's a wide range of responses that that the company wants to introduce, but it can only do that if it is made more clear what issues arise and how they can be dealt with. On the accessibility front, specifically with regard to online things, I am a huge fan of improving the way in which we and others deal with making our online applications usable, particularly for people that have to overcome various and sundry kinds of disabilities, whether they are physical disabilities or cognitive disabilities. It turns out that's really hard. I mean, figuring out how to do a good design, which is intuitive and accounts for the needs of people with disabilities, is quite a challenge. I think it is an art. I don't think that there are textbooks solutions to these things, although there are a number of textbooks that speak to design, which is usable and intuitive. So I'm a big proponent there.